White clover is the most commonly sown legume in Ireland, and it's typically used in grazing mixtures with perennial ryegrass. And I guess the attraction of white clover is its ability to fix nitrogen, and this can be worth about 150 kilos of nitrogen per hectare per year. So it can really make a positive impact on your fertiliser bills. And there's lots of research from around the world, and especially in Ireland, showing that when we have about 20 or 30% white clover in our grazing sward, that we can achieve serious benefits like increased dry matter yield from your grass, increased dry matter intakes from the animals, which drives animal performance in terms of meat and milk production. But I guess in the current climate that we're in at the minute, the biggest attraction of white clover is its impact on your fertiliser bills, providing a benefit both economically and for the environment. So with increasing prices of fertiliser this year, I guess there's a big emphasis on trying to establish and incorporate white clover into our grassland systems. And I guess a full reseed gives you the best chance of success in establishing white clover, but in established swards, and there's so many of them, there's a lot of emphasis on oversowing white clover. And reports on farm are kind of hit and miss. There's a lot of success stories of oversowing and a lot of disaster stories as well. So I suppose DLF have come up with four key points to remember when oversowing white clover this year. The first of these is soil. So we need to pick a paddock that has adequate soil fertility, so our P's, K's and pH need to be optimum. We also need to make sure that we're sowing our white clover seed at the right depth, so no more than 1 centimetre deep, to make sure that we don't lose any of those white clover seeds down the soil. The next one is to roll the seedbed after we sow. It's important to get that soil seed contact after we put out the seed. Second point is timing, so when do we oversow white clover? Ideally we want to be sowing it in April and May when ground temperatures are warming up a bit, so white clover needs 8 degrees to germinate, so in the 8 to 10 degree soil temperature range is what we're looking for. Also, moisture is important to help with germination, so April and May will give us a chance where we'll have adequate rainfall to get germination going. The third point is seed, so we want to oversow our white clover at about 2 to 2.5 kilos an acre of seed. And then depending on the use of the field, we're going to use different types of white clover. So white clover is classified according to its leaf size, and for grazing systems we normally sow a small leaf and a medium leaf variety, and then for silage systems we sow a large leaf variety. So DLF has a couple of blends available this year, so you can choose whether you're going to be grazing primarily or if it's going to be going into a silage ground. So lastly, and possibly most importantly, is light. We want to make sure that light can get down to the new seed to help germinate and establish. So ideally we're going to oversow the white clover after a really tight grazing or after a silage cut, and this allows the light to get down to the new seed. Then ongoing management, after about 7 or 10 days after we oversow, we might bring stock in to clear off any new grass regrowth, again to let the light down to the seedlings. And then for the next 3 rotations, we'll say you want to be grazing at low covers of about 1,000, 1,100 kilos dry matter, just again to let the light in and to give the new clover plants the best chance of establishment. So in terms of our longer term management of clover, say maybe next year once we have it established, again, light is probably the most important thing to remember. So we want to be grazing at low covers, like we need to be getting in at our 1,400-1,500 kilo covers, and we need to be grazing it down to 4 centimetres. Again, it's all with the idea of keeping light into the sward. Another thing is fertiliser management. White clover doesn't kick into action and start fixing the nitrogen for the ryegrass until say May or April when temperatures start to warm up. So for the first few rotations, we need to go with our nitrogen fertiliser as regular. And then once we have a significant portion of white clover, about 20 to 30% white clover in the sward, we can start knocking back our nitrogen and letting the white clover take over the heavy lifting in terms of feeding the grass. So establishing an adequate white clover content in your sward takes time and a little bit of specific management. So DLF would recommend not biting off more than you can chew, and maybe targeting say 30% of the farm in which to establish white clover before you move on to the next section. Red clover is another legume option for farmers looking to reduce their nitrogen fertiliser bill and also grow some home produced protein. So similar to white clover, red clover is a legume. It produces its own nitrogen through the bacteria on its root nodules. So with red clover, we're looking at up to 200 kilos of nitrogen per hectare per year. So if you look at red clover, there's a couple of main key differences between it and white clover. It's a more upright growth habit at the base of the plant here. It also has a much longer, deeper tap root, which helps with the strong summer production of red clover and also gives a little bit of drought tolerance. Some of the differences to identify red and white clover is red clover has hairy leaves, and it also, obviously in the summertime, has that red flower that we all know. Because red clover grows from a central growing point, it's a little bit more exposed to damage from the likes of grazing or tractors or things like that. So for that reason, it's mainly used as a cutting crop. So we're looking to get about 4 silage cuts a year from a red clover ryegrass mixture. We can produce 12 to 16 tons of dry matter per hectare per year, and we're looking at about 16 to 20% crude protein in the crop. So a lot of trials show that the feeding value of red clover is a lot better than perennial ryegrass silage on its own. So we're looking at increased dry matter intakes from the animals, and that's driving on animal performance, whether it's beef cattle like we are here in Billy's, or if it's dairy cows as well. So red clover is a relatively short-term crop. we're looking at about 4 or 5 years persistence of the crop and getting 4 cuts of silage throughout the year. Studies at Chagas Grange have shown that under optimal management conditions, we can get over 6 years out of the crop. So we're looking at things like optimal soil pH, phosphorus and potassium levels, good cutting management. So we want to cut a little bit higher than we would a grass crop. We're looking at about 7 centimeters residual after our silage cuts. And we want to avoid machinery or cattle poaching it in wet weather to prolong the life of the plant. So we're seeing a big interest this year in the use of red clover because of its low cost of production, its relative drought tolerance and its feed quality as well. So today we're with Billy Glasheen outside Waterford City. Last year Billy sowed a mixture of perennial ryegrass and red clover as a trial to see if he could reduce his feed bill and improve the efficiency of his beef finishing system.
I've been looking around for a while to see could we grow our own protein. I'm a beef finisher and I was conscious of the fact that, you know, we need to try and pull back on the amount of soya and protein that we're using. So we saw this red clover last spring, and I actually took 2 cuts off it last year. The year we're going into will be the first full year where I'm hoping to take 4 cuts. But the whole idea of this red clover for me is that I'm hoping to be able to replace the amount of soya that I put into the mix and fattening with red clover. The indications are I should be able to get somewhere between 18 and 20% protein out of the red clover. And my plan really is to be able to reduce the amount of soy that I'm putting into the diet feeder and replace it with red clover. And if I can keep my meal bill down by growing my own protein, I'm not bringing in soy in the gate, I have it in my own bale. That's really the objective. So the first thing we did was we sprayed off the old sward, then we double dist it, and then we power harrowed it, and then we sowed it with a one pass system. Give it a roll. Simple as that. Pretty much the way I do in the normal reseeding around the farm. I'm hoping really that what we have on it now, we've got the trailing shoe, got good quality slurry from one of my fattening tanks. So the whole idea is that we're cutting out fertiliser. So my plan really, this is, it's got its nutrients for the year now and that's it. I cut it 4 times. I should be able to do that with red clover because it generates its own nitrogen.